on Law FM 103.9. And today on the show, we'll be discussing emotional support animals for your mental health. Today on the show, we have a special guest. She has a PhD in dog and pet affairs. Her name is Jackie Idimogu. She's the president of My Dog and I Group. It's a community of dog lovers and also lovers of other kinds of pets. You're welcome, Jackie.
Thank you very much for having me.
You're welcome. So glad to have you on the show. So, sometime last year, I had a very turbulent time emotionally. I was going through a lot emotionally, and I came across a very lovely puppy. It's a Lhasa Alba, and took on the puppy, and I just realized that in learning to care for my dog, I realized that it helped me heal emotionally. I'm just amazed at what the dog did for me. And people say, as a therapist, who's your therapist? Mm-hmm. I found out that my little dog Betty has become my therapist over time. Somehow she doesn't talk. All she just does is cuddle and show me love. But somehow, she's been a therapist for me. And this got me wondering, got me thinking. And I did a lot of research. I went online, did some research, and just said, let me just even find out if there are other people that have experienced what I've experienced. Is this a global phenomenon? Is this just unique to me?
Yes.
And I'm amazed at what I found online, I'm so amazed. I'm amazed at the fact that, licensed therapists abroad would recommend pets as a prescription. Mm-hmm. So you go to see a therapist and you're walking out of the therapy room and they're writing a prescription to go and buy a dog, yes, as a solution instead of medications, yes. And then someone told me about you, that there's a lady called Jackie. She has a PhD in dog affairs. Anything you need to know about pets, ask Jackie. She's there for you. So I'm so glad that you're able to make it.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
So before we go into our conversation, I'll just do a bit of a background. I'll give our listeners a bit of background information. I'll just for you guys to know that there are different categories of dogs or pets. So we have pets, which are the ones you take into the house, which you allow to play with you, not the ones you lock in a cage outside and remain at the gates throughout their entire lifetime. Uh-huh. Pets are pets that you play with, you bath them, you play with them, you feed them, you care for them like you would care for a child. That's what we're talking about. So now, an emotional support animal, which is like a therapy pet, is a pet that has been prescribed by a mental health professional, be it a psychiatrist, a psychologist, or a counselor, to provide emotional support for individuals who might be going through one psychological distress or a mental health condition.
Mm.
Common distressing situations are loneliness, grief, like the recent loss of a loved one, or an opportunity, or a person, or a job, or whatever, grief in whatever form, Loneliness, anxiety, phobias, panic attacks, PTSD,
yes,
depression, and even people on the autistic spectrum also. Mm-hmm. Emotional support animals have been recommended for this group of individuals. Although we have different kinds of pets, we'll be focusing a lot on dogs today.
Okay.
We're paying a lot of attention because I've seen that there's been a lot of extensive work and research in terms of dogs and their care. The phone lines to call or text are 0703-227-7338, 0703-227-7338, or 0909-555-1039. Now, in terms of categorization of these pets or these dogs, in the West or in more advanced countries, dogs have been, the power of these animals have been harnessed for clinical care. So in terms of medicine, they've gone beyond medications, prescriptions. Now we've even harnessed the power of animals to help individuals heal in certain situations. We have some dogs we'll classify as service dogs. So service dogs are dogs that have been individually trained for specific tasks to help people living with disabilities. So for example, we have guide dogs that help people with epilepsy. Epilepsy is an illness where people have, from time to time, have convulsions. So if you have someone with uncontrollable convulsion that needs to go about their business and do things, in the West, a doctor could recommend a guide dog, a dog that has now been trained to help that individual. So whenever, if they are out together and the person suddenly drops and starts to have a seizure with no one else around, the dog has been trained to do certain things, maybe drag the leg to one side, put the arm in a certain way, make sure you remove any harmful thing around, just to make sure the person is safe while the seizure is going on. You know, sometimes they put something on them where they're able to press and then they can reach 911 or whatever. You know, it depends on how advanced it is, but there are certain things that have been put in place for chronic conditions like that. We've also had dogs that have been trained for people that are visually impaired. We're very familiar with that. So people with visual impairment have their walking stick and there's a dog leading them or guiding them. We have for those that are hearing impaired, you know, they're unable to hear, so you have those dogs that would alert them. So someone is at the door and then they press the doorbell, but the person obviously cannot hear it. The dog would alert the person in such situations. So we have dogs trained for such things. And we have, in terms of autistic spectrum disorder, we have dogs that have been trained to help people with sensory over or under stimulation. So a person with sensory under stimulation, and when there's a smoke alarm or there's a smell, there's fire in the building, the person not able to smell the fire as they should, but the dog has been trained, the dog can immediately alert the person and drag the person out of the building, because you know there can be some form of sensory over or under stimulation in people with autistic disorders. Also, autistic disorders with repetitive behaviors. So we, in some people with autism, they could bang their heads on the wall, you know, they could hurt themselves or scratch themselves or cut themselves. Some dogs have been trained that when the person now engages in that behavior, you know, they've been trained to help the person to mitigate the risk or to halt the behavior in those, so they distract the individual from that behavior, so the person is able to come out of themselves in those moments. So we can see that there's a lot of research work going on. It's now beyond drugs, is now even beyond the therapist. Now we've seen that even animals can be used to our advantage, even in mental health. Now there are also dogs we call working dogs. You know, working dogs, we are familiar with, we see them on TV, we see them in the movies, you know, we see them doing search and rescue. There's been an earthquake, you know, they're looking for people. They send the dogs out to sniff out and see if there's anybody alive, you know. We're looking for people in the forest. They send the dogs out, you know, hunting, you know, detection. We see them in the airports. They're sniffing people's bags and all that. Those are working dogs. They're on duty. They're not there to play. They're working in those moments, you know, searching for missing persons. They just give the dog a piece of the person's outfit or shirt or something. Once it sniffs, gets a whiff of the person's scent, it can, you know, find the child or the person from wherever they are, you know. And research has shown that there's some dogs that are very skilled at this. So we have dogs like the bloodhounds. Bloodhounds are very skilled at being working dogs, you know. And they have dogs like the German Shepherds and the Belgian Malinois, who are very good at explosive detection. So those dogs are very skilled when it comes to detecting explosives. So we see that, you know, it's really gone beyond just laughing and playing and chasing around in a compound. We've also had dogs that provide psychiatric services. You know, interestingly, you know, these dogs are able to help people with severe and disabling mental health disorders. So people in delirious states. So when people are delirious, they are unaware of what's going on around them, and in those moments they can harm themselves. They're confused, they don't know where they are. You know, at that point they could fall off a balcony, something could go wrong. So individuals are like that. They can have drugs. Dogs have been trained to protect them in those very critical situations. People with dementia that can wander away, you know, the grandma just takes a walk and next thing we are announcing on the news that we are looking for her, you know. Instead of getting into those kind of occurrences frequently, there can be a dog, you know, attached to the grandma's arm or something, and the dog guides grandma back home whenever she gets lost or gets missing. So these things are being explored. Also, in terms of early signs of relapse, you know, detecting early signs of relapse in people that have disabling, chronic, severe mental health disorders that are not amenable to treatment, dogs can be trained to pick out early signs of relapse and alert, you know, loved ones or relatives when they see the signs. They can also help with medication adherence. So when it's time to use the medication, the dogs can alert the individual that it's time, and then the family or everybody, you know, gets into motion. They have also been very good for allergy detection. So children with allergies, mm-hmm. you know, some dogs like poodles. Poodles are gifted when it comes to helping people with allergy detection. The Portuguese water dog also has been known to be very good. So children that just have recurrent allergies and it's so difficult to manage, you know, maybe getting the poodle might just make a big difference in that child's life, mm-hmm. you know. So this is something that we should think about. The aim of the show is for us to open our minds, you know. I want us to see these animals differently. I want us to look beyond, you know, what we currently see or what the culture has been throwing at us or selling to us. And a very interesting finding that I saw online was that dogs are now being used in cancer research. Mm-hmm. Imagine that a particular breed called the Labrador Retriever has been used in cancer research. So what the scientists have seen is that when people have cancer cells in them that has not been detected, they give off a particular smell from their breath. You know, we as humans can't smell it, mm-hmm. we can't perceive it. But once they expose those dogs in the lab to that cancer smell, and the dog spends some time with that individual sniffing and smelling, the dog can accurately mm-hmm. detect if there's a cancer cell growing in that individual. Mm-hmm. And they saw that with repeated exercises, they got a 98% accuracy rate when compared to rapid test kits and some test kits. So every time the dogs got it right and they compared with extensive cancer testing, the dogs were 98% correct, you know, as compared to test kits which were 10% accurate most of the time. So it just shows that we're really going beyond run, catch, fetch, throw, fetch, mm-hmm. catch, and all that. Dogs are being used in so many clinical situations. We can even advocate for dog use in nursing homes, in rehab centers, in hospice care, in clinical settings, because they also can be trained to play certain roles in those settings. So these dogs are important because they would help provide emotional support and comfort, you know, and help the person that they're managing or their handler or their owner, you know, deal with challenges that might have otherwise compromised their quality of life. So I'm coming as the theoretical person, the little experience in dog ownership, you know, but now I'm going to hand it over to our PhD in dog pet care. Just take us to school and just teach us about, you know, dog life. But first, I just want to understand your history of your love for pets, because I know you have birds, you have bunnies, you have dogs, mm-hmm. not just one dog.
Yes,
you have four dogs.
Yes, four dogs.
Wow. So you're definitely a dog lover. Just tell us your history of your love for pets. How did it come about, and tell us about the journey?
I've always been an animal lover. I grew up loving animals, saving animals, rearing all types of animals, you know, but, you know, dogs always stand out. So I've always owned dogs growing up, you know, with my family, and now being able to not just own dogs but create a community around it, create a livelihood around it. It's like, it's my passion, it's what I want to do, it's what I love to do. So that has taken it up a notch. So I'm not just a dog lover, I'm like an exemplary dog lover for especially Nigerians, teaching them how to, you know, go about this thing the right way. Positive pet ownership. Yes.
So what's the pet culture like now in Nigeria?
Oh, the pet culture in Nigeria right now is booming. It has grown rapidly over the years. People are beginning to turn to dogs for companionship, emotional support, and everything. People are beginning to choose dogs over humans, dare I say.
Interesting.
So they are beginning to understand that if you're looking for loyalty and unconditional love, that's the way to go. Yes.
I remember when I first got my dog, I heard some comments like, this woman doesn't even know what she wants to do again. Hmm. Now she's focusing on dogs. Mm-hmm. It's like, what kind of waste of money is this?
Yes.
Imagine, humans are not eating, the dog is eating. You know?
Yeah.
But it goes beyond that. They don't understand that dogs play a role in helping you maintain your mental health.
Of course, they can act
as a therapist to the therapist.
More than even therapists, dogs are now kids. They are now like part of the family. So we no longer call dogs just dogs. We call them four babies. So I'm a dog mom. If you own a dog and you are a dog lover, not a dog owner, then you are referred to as a dog mom, and that's referred to as your four baby.
What's the difference between a dog lover and a dog owner?
Well, a dog lover is a person that doesn't joke with their dog. The person that sees their dog as their child, as their family, as their kin. A person that keeps the dog in the house. In fact, I gave conditions of how to know that you're a certified dog owner. You prepare your dog's meal. You make sure your dog is well groomed, looks as good as your human child will. The dog owner gets a dog for security, keeps the dog outside in a cage, and doesn't give
attention
to the dog. And anything happen to the dog, come rain, come sunshine, that's the dog's business. But the dog lover nurtures the dog, keeps it. There's something you call a soul dog. You have a dog that has a connection to your spirit. Do you understand? Like, you cannot do anything for the sake of you cannot see that dog suffer for any reason. That's a dog lover.
So what would you say to people that feel it's a waste of time and a waste of resources?
Well, they have not loved the dog. That's if you love a dog, you will know that there's nothing you do for a dog that is ever too much. I've seen people fly their dogs first class. They are sitting and their dog is sitting beside them.
One is extreme.
Yes. Because that dog is their whole world. To you, it's just a dog. But to them, that's their entire world there.
To the dog is playing. It's more than what we're seeing.
Exactly.
So there's some emotional need the dog is most likely meeting.
There is a vacuum. There's a void that dog is filling that you... 10,000 of you cannot feel. So that's why that person would do anything and everything for that dog. Without even batting an eye.
So we can't just judge from the outside.
Exactly.
It goes beyond that.
So we're trying to teach people to respect people's dogs. Because to you, it might look, vain from outside. But to that person, that dog sitting down there is everything. Means the world.
Yeah. So the research has even shown that caring for a pet or a dog can have mental and physical health benefits.
Yes.
And one of the interesting things is that when you play with your dogs, you release certain endorphins. So there's certain chemicals we call endorphins in the body, such as oxytocin, serotonin, dopamine. These are chemicals we give as medications for depression and anxiety and all kinds of things. Now, playing with that dog releases endorphins naturally in the body.
Yes.
And when you release these endorphins, it has an inverse relationship with cortisol. So the more endorphins you release, your cortisol levels go down. Cortisol is responsible for stress. The more cortisol you have, the more stressed out you feel, So when you have increased endorphins, cortisol levels go down, you feel happier, your mood improves, you sleep better. The risk of depression goes down, and even if you are depressed, you start to feel happier. So these are some of the benefits, people that have been proven from caring for pets.
Proven.
We also have work-related stress. It helps reduce work-related stress. Abroad now, they're even advocating that we should make the workplace pet-friendly.
Yes.
If you have a pet, you can take your dog to the pet and
bring your dog
back
to
the
work
dog somewhere in the office there.
Yes.
And when you're leaving, you carry your dog with you home, Make it more, because it's been shown to help reduce work-related stress. Mm-hmm. Like I just explained, there's a biological reason for it.
Yeah.
Cortisol level goes down. You feel happier in the workplace. Mm-hmm. You're more productive.
Yeah.
You mix around more in the office.
Yeah.
The workplace is happier, It also helps companionship. If you live alone or you now have an empty nest, all the children have moved on to the university, you're just alone with your spouse, or there's some need for companionship.
Mm-hmm.
A dog can play that role. Or there's been a recent loss, bereavement. A dog can fill in that void during that process of healing. Those say dogs help us remain active. You have to walk your dog from time to time. They get you active. You run around.
You play with them.
It helps you as well. And the more active you are, the more endorphins you release. It lowers your blood pressure, lowers your cholesterol levels, improves your mood, and so many other benefits. And even in caring for the dog, the fact that you have to feed your dog, bath your dog,
it creates a routine that keeps your mind off, thinking about negativity and all that. Personally, that's what my dogs do for me. They help me. They create a balance in my life. Mm. They strike this balance. Because I'm wondering if I'm not making their meal or taking them out to pee or taking them, what will I be doing with that time, that spare time? Mm-hmm. I'll probably be thinking, sulking and all that. But it just helps me create a routine and a balance. Yeah. And it gives a sense of responsibility and timing.
Yes, very fantastic. And in the long run, it helps you feel better. That sense of satisfaction helps you feel better. Do you know that, Jackie, we found out that studies have been done on people that have survived stroke and heart disease, and they found out that people in recovery from stroke and heart disease who during that period of recovery had a pet around them that was also helping to care for them, they got well faster than those that were cared for by humans alone. So is it that dogs are more loyal and they care for you more?
Can I tell you why? A human being is caring for you. You are not sure of their intention 100%. A dog is caring for you. You know that it's 100% dog is 100% dedication. Happy and doing it from their mind, from their hearts. That alone gives you peace of mind. Yes.
So people that have stroke and heart attack should not shy away from getting recommendations of having a dog on board to care for them. Good morning. We have a call. Good morning, this is the Legit Therapy Show. May I know your name and where you're calling from? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, hello?
Good morning, may I know your name? Good morning.
Yeah, my name is David from Yaba. Good morning.
Good morning, David. Thanks for calling.
Yeah.
Do you have a question for Jackie?
Yes, thank you. I'm also an avid pet lover.
Okay.
And I want to know how we can start pushing for dogs that can protect our pets and our dogs. For instance, some months ago I heard a dog was shot by security personnel in an estate. So you can imagine the trauma that the dog owner, the family that owns the dog, the children, you can imagine the trauma they went through. So can we start pushing for more animal protection laws like we have in the Western world, more advanced countries?
Much so we'll talk a bit more about that when we progress in the show, but thank you so much for your contribution. Thank you.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Okay, I think we had talked about that, so we'll go into that a bit when we get to the culture. When we talk about culture. Okay, so we were talking about dogs helping you, heart attack, people healing from stroke and heart attack, and seeing that those that had a pet involved in their healing process recovered faster than those that didn't. And then we've seen that if you're very shy, if you're a very shy person, you don't do well in social situations, that even getting a pet can help improve your social skills.
It's been shown that
it helps. So there's so much we can actually harness from animals, from pets, you know. So we need to even talk about the culture. So what's our culture like in terms of, you know, because I've heard several things. Cats, you know, dogs are for eat some certain parts of the country. Dogs are meant to be eaten, they're not to be played with. You should just eat them and keep them at the gate, you know. Cats are witches, especially if it's a black cat. It's definitely a witch from the hometown, you know. Birds can mean different things. If it's a white bird, it's a good sign. Peace. If it's a black bird, there's something going on. There's an evil bird, you know.
Dog, I don't.
Some people feel like bunnies should not be pets. Bunnies should be eaten. They're very yummy. They're delicious to be cooked. So, what from your experience? What are the myths we see around? What's the culture like? What just like how you said, how can someone? I think I saw that video, and they just put a gun to the dog's neck and they videoed the dog bleeding. Yeah. That was so horrific. You know, terrible. how why? Okay, even if you don't love dogs, but then that's, you just sucked out the life out of something. Mm. You know, so these are some of the things we see around. Can you just share from experience, you know?
My dear, like he rightly asked, there are actually laws in Nigeria that protect these animals, that protect dogs, protect pets, even animals that are meant for eating. There are even laws that protect them, but the laws are not being enforced. Mm. So we've been trying our best to create awareness to make sure that, you know, people realize that these animals are actually protected by Nigerian law. Mm. But enforcing them is another thing, which is why we have, you know, been shouting justice for Roxy, justice, like he mentioned, you know. And in terms of the society and the culture, like you said, there's a lot of diabolism being attached to animals, and it's not fair on them. Really, it's not fair on them. Dogs, we are trying to stop dog eating. As if you see, for me, I don't know. I feel like if you can kill a dog, you can kill someone, because you literally see life in their eyes. You literally see them begging you not to do this. So we are trying to stop, you know, eating of dogs. Then as for cats are very beautiful animals. Do you understand? Personally, I think it's because they are so beautiful and they have the most beautiful eyes. That's why people are scared of them. You know, when something is so fine that is not like, it's too much.
Was it the whiskers?
Yes, they are just very beautiful. There's nothing diabolic about cats. They're just very majestic. The way they walk slowly, and most times they want to be on their own. Yeah, so they could just creep up on you, and it can scare you if you're someone that's not very relatable to animals. But there's nothing diabolical about cats.
Yeah.
Then birds. If a bird just mistakenly flies into your house, there are many reasons why birds can mistakenly fly into your house. We have cut away all of the trees in Lagos, especially. Where do you expect them to pitch? Where do you expect them to find soccer or balance, especially in the rainy season? Their wings get caught in electric cables and all that, and then they fly. And
you say it's a witch that
did not come back to. Meanwhile, this bird is in pain, needs help. Do you understand? So it's unfair the way we treat our animals. It's unfair. Really, it is. We need to start being more, showing more empathy towards these animals, because we are really taking away all of their habitats. And bunnies are not food. Please, I beg you people. Rabbits are very beautiful. They make very lovely pets. People don't know this, but bunnies make very lovely pets. They show love and affection, and they actually lick you, you know, to show love, just the same way dogs do. Yeah, people don't know this. They are wonderful pets. And for people that live in estates where, you know, they are telling them not to bring dogs because of the barking and everything, you can opt for a bunny. They are almost the same thing. Even bunny walk on leashes now. You take your bunny out to the beach and all that. Yeah, and they are easily litter trained like cats, so they are very intelligent. Okay. So it's a good option or alternative if you don't want a dog because of the backing.
Okay, just going back to Roxy's case, what are the situations where you are allowed to put down a dog? Are there certain that can warrant a person that is that makes it lawful to put down a dog? What are those kind of situations?
If the dog has actually attacked someone,
okay,
if the dog is actually holding on to someone and is not letting go, although there are also means to make the dog let go, which I don't even want to start diving into now, but yeah, those are cases or scenarios. Or if the dog attacks a child,
I once heard something about if it's drawn blood. So if a dog has tasted blood, then you have to put it down. Is that true?
I don't know about tasted blood. Nigerians come with this tasted blood thing.
Like if they bite you and then you bled, you know that, then that dog needs to go.
I mean, but there are dogs that are trained to bite though. Like police dogs, walking
those
dogs.
Those are different now. Those are different. Walking dogs are different. Yeah. But I'm just talking about the household pets. You know, that has been fed cooked food all his life, and then one time
but depends who
goes after someone and bites an intruder. Because from what I heard that if he tests blood once, he might want it blood again.
No, they are not, so they're not carnivorous. They are not taste blood one blood vampires. blood vampires. No, they're actually dogs that actually eat raw meat. There are people that feed their dogs raw meat.
Is that
actually
good?
Very good for them, yes.
Doesn't it make them crave, like, if they bite you?
If you feed raw, it will make them clear.
Like, if they actually do bite you for once, then they will want...
No.
It's just like a shark in water. A shark, someone has a cut and goes into the water, and sharks see that blood.
They smell blood and they want blood. They're drawn to blood. Dogs are not.
Oh, naturally, they're not. Okay, but the wild ones, like the wolves, are drawn to blood.
Oh, well, yes.
But you're saying the domesticated ones are not. Yes. Okay. Let me just read this comment. So, and we also have a call coming in.
Okay.
Okay, let's get the call first. Good morning. This is the Legit Therapy Show. May I know your name and where you're calling from? Hello? Hello? Okay. Lost that call. So there's a text. We got a text here. It says, "Hi, Dr. Jibs. OMG. Oh my God. This topic is so good. We don't treat animals well in this country. We need to do better. I have a dog and she's very great. She's an awesome companion. Is there any criteria for having a pet like outside the country?"
Criteria for having a pet outside the country? I don't understand the question.
Like maybe outside this country, are there certain, I don't know.
Like she wants to take.
I don't. Maybe here. Outside. Maybe here you can randomly get a pet. Guess going for having a pet like outside the country. Do you understand?
I mean, abroad they don't take it. Having a pet abroad is a very serious responsibility. Your dog must be microchipped and registered to a veterinary. As against here, where you can just
randomly
get a dog and you know put a dog in your house. Yeah.
But I think in terms of maybe location too. So some areas where you live, you can have pets. Some areas are not. Pets are not allowed.
In Nigeria,
maybe abroad. I think abroad.
I don't know if there's anywhere abroad pets.
That pets are not allowed. Really?
It's just there are certain breeds that some states don't allow. Oh. Like there are some states that don't allow pit bulls, Rottweilers.
Oh.
Yeah,
okay.
They're forbidden. Yeah.
Okay.
But dogs are allowed everywhere.
Okay. Okay. Interesting. Interesting. Yeah. Calls coming in. Okay. Good morning. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello, good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
Young China, I'm calling from
Lexi. Okay, good morning, Young China. Good morning.
I called last week to follow your program. I'm really a big fan of you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, today I have a question for your colleagues.
Okay.
Okay, aside from, what other animal is as loyal as dogs? Do you want to have another pet aside dogs? I'm scared of dogs. Well, any other pet that is as loyal as that I can get for myself, I would like to know.
What if Jackie also teaches you how to love a dog? Skills. She'll teach us. So she'll share. Wow. She'll answer your question, and let's see if she can also get you to love a dog.
Okay, and if she can get me an alternative too.
All right, thank you so much. Thank you.
All right,
thank you.
Oh my god, he said, what's an alternative to
a dog?
But you know, he said something. He said, what other animal is as loyal?
Yes.
That word loyal underlined,
yes,
then you can't get it anywhere. Wow. The loyalty of a dog is, I don't know, it's from heaven. They are the most loyal companions. But what I will ask him
first, a dog will take a bullet for you,
of course,
anytime.
What I'll ask him first, I always like to ask, what is the trigger? What's triggering your fear? What's the fear? Where is the fear coming from for dogs? Have you been beaten before, or you just don't like their hair? Some people don't like things crawling up to them. So if I can find out what exactly the foundation of his fear is coming from, then maybe
I can address it
and then tell him a type of dog that he can start with, you know. Starters that will help him just get over that fear.
Talking about type of dogs now, so someone like him who has a fear, what kind of dog would I advise someone like him to get to start, that will get him to start to love
dogs,
and then he can now move on to other kinds of breeds?
I'll tell him to get like a pet dog, like a small puppy breed. Start from puppyhood, but get a dog that's like a miniature breed, maybe like a pug. I'll try to get him to get a dog that doesn't need a lot of, you know, time, you know, and that is not too clingy.
Okay.
Yes, because if he gets a dog that is too clingy, it might be overwhelming for him.
Okay.
Yeah, so we could do a Maltese. But he will have to keep the hello. He could do a pug, could do a Frenchie.
Okay.
A Frenchie would be good because he doesn't have to groom a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, just something small like that he can, you know,
start off with
and work his way up.
Okay. And then from there he can now graduate to other breeds of dogs. Fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
So you've told our caller now that the most loyal he can get is a dog.
Is a dog, really? Yes.
Okay, that's fantastic. How important is a dog or pets rearing in child rearing? So when we have young children, do you think it's important? Do you think as parents, you know, getting our children introduced to pets and grooming of pets and raising pets can have an impact on their
development? It's the best way to raise good children. You want your child to be kind, you want your child to be responsible, you want your child to respect nature, you want your child to have a sense of
responsibility.
Get that child a dog. Get that
even
dog.
Loyalty. The yes, dog will loyalty. Teach your child to, loyalty.
Yes,
empathy.
Empathy. It will teach a child a lot.
Yeah.
Dog lovers are the best. If you can love a dog, that if you can love a dog that doesn't say anything, that doesn't say thank you or anything, selflessly, you take care of that dog, you bait it, you comb it, you groom it, you know when to feed your dog. Imagine a child growing up with that amount of responsibility and kindness and selflessness.
Wow.
That child would be a wonderful adult.
Yeah, yes. Naturally. I agree with you. I agree. Several studies, several research has proven that this is true.
Mm-hmm.
I agree with you.
So I think parents, when you're getting a dog, when you're getting a dog for your kids, just tell them, you're the one that will take care of this dog. Or make them promise, because every child wants a dog. Yeah. Make them promise that it's their responsibility, and they will say yes. They will excitedly say
yes. And
that would
do a lot for them.
That would do a lot for them.
And even if they learn to train the dog too, that would also do a lot for
them.
Yes. So they're in the training process.
Oh, there's nothing more beautiful than a puppy growing up with a child together. It's so beautiful.
Yeah, you're right. So are we now saying that all animals can be trained?
Wow, Doc.
Because I've seen some videos, some really crazy videos online. I see some guys
if there's one
pecking lions and hugging lions and feeding lions, and I'm like, what's going on? Are those videos true?
Yes, they are true. Recent studies have shown that there's no animal that doesn't respond to love.
Yeah, so wait, is it that those lions were picked up as cubs? So they've gotten used to their owners.
Most of them were not even picked up as cubs. Most of them were rescues. I don't know. I feel like now, if you show an animal just a little amount of love, care, they respond 10 times.
But I don't think it applies to snakes, though.
Are you joking?
Oh.
I have a friend that owns a snake. A pet snake. In Funny Nigeria. Enough, the snake's name is Jacqueline.
In Nigeria?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Python.
Hey, in Nigeria? Very
well-trained python, yeah. Ah. She's in his house.
You're saying that the snake won't turn on her one day.
On
can
him?
Happen now. Oh, to him.
Oh, to him. No, he won't. She won't turn on him.
But they are wild.
He's had her for a very long time.
What does the snake eat?
Rats.
Oh.
Lizards.
Fantastic. He's helping the community.
Oh, yes, you see, that's the thing. You cannot do without animals because they play a very huge role in the ecosystem.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So everything responds to love. Snake, lion, deer, crocodile. You've not seen croc men where they're carrying their crocs?
Oh, my God.
Hey. Kissing their croc in the teeth.
Hey.
No. He will put his
hand. But they're not Nigerians, I'm sure they're not Nigerians.
No, Nigerians have not gotten to that level. But we're getting there. So.
Oh, my God. Yes. This is really interesting. We'll take a quick break, and then when we get back, we'll discuss further.
All right.
This is the Legit Therapist on Law FM 103.9. The Legit Therapist with Dr. Jibs will be right back.
Who let the dogs out?
Nice, the party was pumping.
Yippee-i-yo.
And everybody having a ball.
Yippee-i-yo.
Until the fellas start the name calling.
Yippee-i-yo.
And the girls respond to the call. I have a poor one shout out.
Who let the dogs out?
Bash Gruffy, get back, you flea, invest in mongrel. Gonna tell myself I'm man, no get angry.
Hey, yippee-i-yo.
Two Eddie cows calling them canine. Hey,
yippee-i-yo.
But they tell me, hey man, start up the party.
Yippee-i-yo.
You put a woman in front and a man behind. I have a woman shout out.
Who let the dogs out?
If
scruffy, bad scruffy, get back, you flea infesting mongrel.
All right, so we're back again on the Legit Therapy Show, and today we're talking about emotional support animals for your mental health. We're talking about the role that dogs can play in therapy, especially dogs, but of course all animals can help in therapy, but today we're focusing on dogs, and we have our expert in the house, so PhD dog affairs, dogmatics, dog everything, Jackie. Thank you again for joining us on the show.
Thank you for having me.
So just want you to just share with us from your expertise some of the things we can do in unexpected situations. So sometimes you go to someone's house, you don't know they have a dog, you know, you don't know they're a dog owner. So there's a dog owner who's let out the dog from the cage. You had no idea there was something like that, and you walk in and the dog is coming at you. In that situation, teach us, what are some things we can do to protect ourselves?
Yes. So when you have a dog charging at you, first thing you do is you tuck in.
When you have a dog charging at you, first thing you do is tuck in your limbs. You know, dogs like to attack anything dangling. So you tuck in your arms, try to fold your arms. Look for the nearest exit first. If the nearest exit look around you. If the nearest exit is far, then you know you are in for a tussle. So first and foremost, don't put eye contact. Don't make eye contact with the dog. The dog will see you as less threatening if you are not looking it in the eye. Tuck in your arms, and if the dog is sniffing you or trying to tug at you, push you, the safest thing to do is to lie down on the floor and coil up into a ball. That way you're protecting everything that is important, all of your vitals. You curl up your leg like this, and then you put your head down. And
can you scream?
No, don't scream. Worst case scenario, the dog will sniff. Probably use the nudge to like nudge you and go. If the dog is intent on playing with you or causing harm, probably pull on your shirt a bit. Hopefully the owner of the dog is around to recall the dog, you know, at this. But some dogs, if you just put your head down and fold your arms, they will just run towards you and stop and go back, you know. But there are some dogs that are meant to attack, like
they're
trained to attack intruders. So if you meet that type of dog,
no matter what you do,
I'm sorry,
so no matter what you do, it would attack, because that's how it's been trained.
Yeah, but this is what I'm telling you now, is how to protect yourself from serious injuries. Yes,
so it's a bad idea to see and run immediately. Is that a bad
idea? It's a bad idea to see and run if the exit is far away, because you cannot outrun the dog. It's impossible.
Okay.
If you see something to climb, fine.
Some dogs climb trees. Oh my god!
Enjoy you there.
Oh my goodness! They can climb a tree. They can climb a car too.
Yeah.
Oh my god!
But I always beg people to please respect dogs. Even as a dog lover, you know, when you meet a dog, try to keep your distance. Ask the owner if it's okay to touch their dog, to pet their dog. And when you're trying to pet a dog, don't just put your hand like this. Give the dog the back of your hand to sniff first. Don't just touch a dog's head. They don't like it so much when a stranger does that. So let them sniff you, let them get to know you first before you just put yourself all over them. You have to respect these creatures.
I'm sorry, they don't like you when you pull their tails. Is that true?
Yes, they don't like their tails to be tugged. But there are some dogs that will accommodate it from children. If it's a child, they will let it do whatever they want.
So what if you have, for example, I know Lassas are one of the friendliest and easygoing dogs who laughs and plays with everybody, but then he sees one particular individual and starts to bark, but doesn't bark at other people. What does that mean?
The dog is trying to tell you that that person is not a good person.
Oh, really?
Yes, because dogs have
intuitions. They can detect that?
Yes. They know how to, I don't know, call it sixth sense, call it, I don't know what it is, but they can tell a good person and a bad person. Yes. So if your dog is very playful and is just barking at
one particular person,
then you know that you should
be
wary of that person. If your dog doesn't like a particular person, you know that person is not good for you.
Really? Yes. That's interesting. Any other sixth sense that we should be aware of?
They also can
call us any. Oh, really?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
I've been posting videos to prove that analogy, actually.
But what do they do when they see ghosts?
If your dog just starts back in the middle of the night, looking, just facing here, and you are looking at it,
and you can't see anything.
And sometimes you see the hair in the middle of their
That is goosebumps. Spine.
It stands up and they're just barking intensely. Sometimes they even shiver and they whine a little like they're saying something that you're not saying. Wow. Yeah, that's a very whole different story. Very creepy.
That's fantastic. That's interesting.
Yes.
But my producer is very interested. Dig a little deeper into the sixth sense thing. This is interesting.
Yeah.
So we should be sensitive to their reactions.
Yes, be sensitive to your dog's reactions. Okay. Because they hear things and see things that you cannot see normally. Because their seeing and hearing is way above human human hearing and seeing too.
Thank you so much, Jackie. Is there anything else that we haven't touched on? I think you've just taken us to school. You've taught us everything and everything.
To take care of your dogs more, show them more love. And I also want to appreciate all the dog lovers out there for the timeless job you people do with your dogs. You guys are amazing. God bless all the dog lovers out there.
And then coming from my therapy table,
yes,
I want us to understand that when we see people with dogs, let's not just assume that they're vain and they've got nothing else to do with their money. You know, that dog might be meeting a very serious emotional need. Mm. That dog might be helping that person go through grief, loneliness, some emotional or psychological issue. I can personally testify that dogs help us through our emotional and psychological challenges and can actually lift you out of that phase. Because the same endorphins I would prescribe in the clinic for you to go and swallow, the drug can help you produce it naturally and help you heal. So on this note, we've come to the end of the show, and we'll be back again next week, Wednesday, by 11 a.m. Thank you for listening.